So, well, hello everyone. Last time we have seen about evaluating evidence and causality. So, in that time we have seen about introduction. We have been about the role of chance. We have seen about the role of bias, and in detail, we have seen the selection bias and its types or examples, and information bias and its types and examples. So, and also ways of minimizing the selection bias and ways of minimizing information bias have been discussed. So, today we will see about the role of confounding, which is if there is one association between cause and effect, should be judged for chance bias and confounding. So the third type is confounding. Now we will start about the confounding, the role of confounding. After completing confounding, we will see about judgment of causality. So now we will see about the role of confounding. So role of confounding. So now what is confounding? Confounding is a distortion of estimated effect of an exposure on an outcome caused by the presence of an extraneous factor associated with both with exposure and the outcome. So due to the presence of extraneous, an extra factor, that factor is associated with exposure and outcome. So due to presence of extraneous factor, like which is related to exposure outcome, due to that the effect of exposure on outcome will be distorted. This is known as confounding. So the factor is known as confounding factor. So confounding variable is not an intermediate variable, is associated with the factor under investigation. So confounding variable is not an intermediate variable, it will associated with the risk factor under investigation. The confounder is a variable that can cause or prevent the outcome of interest. So, one, they can cause or prevent, the outcome of interest. Two, they are associated with the factor under investigation. Three, they are not an intermediate variable. So the role of confounding, this is very important concept. To bring a confounding effect, that confounding variable must fulfill each of the following criteria. So by the way, to say to see there is confounding factor, or the confounding factor affects one's finding, we should fulfill three criteria. One, the confounding factor must be associated with exposure. The one, there is a relation with the exposure, and independent of that exposure, a B risk factor for the disease. So one, there is a relationship with exposure. So without exposure, there is a risk factor for a disease. So this criteria should be fulfilled. The other is distribution. Frequency of confounding variable should vary between groups that are compared. For instance, there is male, there is female groups. So between the frequency of the finding between male and female should be different. There is no equal. For instance, for male, odds ratio is 2. For female, odds ratio 2. There is no confounding variable. It should be varied. The third one is a confounder must not be an intermediate link in causal pathway between exposure and outcome. So it should not be. Must not be intermediate link. So these three criteria is fulfilled, we can say confounding variable. If not fulfilled, we can say not confounding variable. So this is a very important thing. For instance, the one which is lung cancer and smoking, alcohol drinking is a confounding variable, because mostly being smokers will be their drunkards. So ethylator is the exposure variable, so it may be independently will cause lung problem. So if or stomach problem, if cause stomach problem, so it will be confounding variable. Let us see the example. Anyway, so when we judge the confounding, this is variable E exposure, this is disease. So exposure will lead to disease. Then there is confounding factor here. So the confounding factor, the one is there is the relationship with exposure, relationship with the other, independent of this exposure, it will lead to disease. It will lead to disease. So this is known as confounding variable. Confounding variable. So the one which have an effect to cause the disease independent of exposure, the other is also there is a relationship with exposure. So this is known as confounding variable. But in this case, there is exposure here, there is disease here. So this is intermediate link in the middle. In this case, there is no confounding. If intermediately, there is no, that means exposure will lead to this variable will lead to this. That means there is no relationship with exposure. So if there is no relationship with exposure, we can say that it is a confounding factor. It is an intermediate link. So the role of confounding, an example of confounding effect, unobserved association between consumption of coffee and increased risk of myocardial infarction could be due to, at least in part, to the effect of cigarette smoking. Yes, so since coffee drinking is associated with smoking and independent of coffee consumption, smoking is a risk factor for myocardial infarction. So by the way, in this case, as a study, by the way, let us explain about this concept. There is a study which intended to know about the association between coffee drinking and myocardial infarction. So the study wanted to know is drinking coffee will lead to myocardial infarction. So in this study, smoking cigarette will be a confounding factor. Cigarette smoking will be confounding factor. Smoking cigarette independently or in part, independently, fully or independently in part, will lead to myocardial infarction. Second, cigarette smoking also having relationship with coffee. Mostly, those who smokers will drink coffee, or those who smokers will drink coffee because of to get stimulated effect. So cigarette smoking having relationship with coffee and also independently will lead to myocardial infarction. So cigarette smoking is considered to be confounding factor. So confounding variable has three effects. The one, totally or partially accounts for the apparent effect. This is known as positive confounding. That means totally or partially accounting for apparent effect means this is overestimate. This is known as positive confounding. The other is mask an underlying true association. This is known as negative confounding, meaning in this case, this true association is masked. This is known as underestimate. The other is reverse the actual direction of the association. Reverse the actual direction of association. Reverse the actual direction of the association. In this case, three things have the ability to do that with confounding variable. Confounding variable has an effect either overestimate or underestimate or reverse the direction of an association. So confounding must be built as quantitative problem. The amount of confounding rather than mere presence or absence of that is important to evaluate. That means whether there is confounding or not. Rather than whether there is confounding or not, it's better to understand to what amount this confounding variable affects the finding is very important. So effect of confounding have three things, so this is important, don't forget that. So positive confounding, negative confounding, and reverse direction. So control for confounding variables, that is very important concept. So we have got a confounding variable, we got a confounding variable. So what is the control mechanism, how to control this confounding variable is an important step. So we have six type of controlling mechanisms, but the three are done on the design stage, the three are on the analyze stage. But matching is happened on we can do matching on the design stage as well as on analyze stage. Analyzing matching is occur both. So randomization is done on the design stage, restriction is on design stage, and matching is both. And standardization is done on the analysis, stratification is on analysis stage, and multivariate analysis is on analysis stage. So let us see all one by one. This is very important concepts. Randomization ensures that all potential confounding factors are evenly distributed among treatment groups. That means confounding factors are evenly distributed among treatment and control groups. Then that means, by the way, the very important concept of randomization is it can evenly distribute confounding variables. These confounding variables are for known and unknown. Unknown and unknown factors or confounding factors will be adjusted or distributed. So this is a randomization is a very important thing, which is done on the design stage. When using randomization to control confounding, it is important that sample size of the study be sufficiently large. So the other is restriction. Restrict the admissibility criteria for subjects and limit entrance into study to individuals who fall within a specific category. Or categories of the confounder. So those who have categories of confounder, or those who specific individuals which affect the finding will be excluded, or restrict the admission criteria. So this is known as restriction. The other is, for example, if cigarette smoking is a potential confounding factor, so the study could include only smokers or only non-smokers should be included. That means if smokers are confounder, non-smoker will be included. So this is a mechanism. The other is matching. Matching can be done during design and analysis stage. In both stage, particular subjects are selected in such a way that the potential confounders are distributed in identical manner among each study group. That means between treatment and control groups. So this is matching means individual would be matched between two groups. This is most commonly done in the case control study. So matching is primarily used in case control study. So case control study based on matching, case control study is divided into two. If matched, we can say match case control study. If is didn't match or does not match, but we can say unmatched case control study. So mostly observed studies are unmatched case control study that we have seen, but there is also matched case control study. So if they are matched, that means confounding variable will be minimized, because confounding variable be known and selected and matched for that variable. So matching is nice. The other is multivariate analysis. The very important one is this one, and we are commonly done is this one, multivariate analysis. A fundamental problem with stratified analysis, which we get next is Next is stratified analysis. So in stratified analysis, that it is inability to control simultaneously for an even moderate number of potential confounders. Meaning, by the way, stratified analysis and multivariate analysis, they are very good, which is found on the analysis stage, but stratified analysis no control more variables, one, the other is not controlled simultaneously, but the most important thing, which control simultaneously, and we can add or we can control more variables, is multivariate analysis or multivariable regression analysis. So this, in this case, multivariate analysis allows for sufficient estimation of measures of association while controlling for the number of confounding factors simultaneously. The most common way that many factors are controlled for simultaneously is through the use of multivariable regression model. For continuous outcome, multiple regression model, by using multiple regression model. For binary logistic regression, by using multivariable regression model. If it is logistic, multivariable logistic regression model. So how to do that? Because we will do binary logistic regression analysis. So in that case, each individual is treated individually, each variable is treated individually, but all that variables will be inserted into multivariable logistic regression analysis. So we will control all confounding variables simultaneously. If you join 20 variables, it will adjust for 20. It will adjust all 20 variables. It will control all variables. If it is 10, we will control it. If it's 100, we will control it. So limited number of variables will be controlled or adjusted simultaneously at the same time. So this is the most common way. This is the most common way what we have used in our analysis, especially in the case of cross-sectional study analysis. In the case of cross-sectional, multivariate analysis is an optional. It's most commonly used for that. The last one is stratified analysis. Stratified analysis involves the evaluation of association within homogeneous categories or strata of the confounding variable. In this case, there is stratified analysis. Hypothesis: high alcohol consumption is associated with stomach cancer. It is case control study. So our hypothesis is there high alcohol consumption will lead to stomach cancer. So by this case, the study is concerned about alcohol consumption and stomach cancer. So there is stomach cancer, and without stomach cancer here, there is exposed and non-exposed, meaning there is alcohol consumers here, non-alcohol consumers is here. So this, in this case, odds ratio is calculated 62 over 68, and also 75 over 95. In this case, odds ratio is 2.47. In this case, if you are interpreted, the odds of being exposed to high alcohol consumption appear to be 2.47 times higher for stomach cancer cases as compared to controls. The risk of stomach cancer is 2.47 times higher in persons with high alcohol consumption as compared to the persons without high alcohol consumption. This is what we made usually. But we should check whether there is confounding variable or not for stomach cancer. In this case, stratified analysis, in this case, but what about smoking? Smoking is a confounding factor. Those who smokers will be drinkers. That is associated with exposure variable. The other smoker also partly will cause stomach cancer or fully. So in this case, smoking is not intermediate factor. There is no intermediate link. One, the other is associated with stomach cancer and alcohol consumption, both incidence and outcome. So this considered as, smoking is considered as confounding variable, but we will check it through analysis, stratified analysis, whether it is smoking is confounding or not. Perhaps the case were more likely to be smokers than control subjects, since heavy consumers of alcohol may also be likely to be smokers. So in other words, maybe high alcohol consumption has little to do with risk of stomach cancer, independent of smoking. That means if without smoking, maybe alcohol consumption will lead little effect on stomach cancer. So let us see stratified analysis between non-smokers and smokers.
That's why we said homogeneous group means we will do in non-smokers and we will do in smokers.
So odds ratio in non-smokers are will be 1.71. Odds ratio in smokers will be 1.69. So there is difference. There is 1.71. It is 1.69. So there is difference between two groups. So is there evidence that smoking confounds the relationship between alcohol consumption and stomach cancer? We can say yes, even if there is minimal difference. So the two things are different. So since the outcome is the finding is different between two groups, there is it is confounding variable. But if it is the two groups are similar, we can say there is no confounding variable. So now having this concept, now we are asking about, is association causal? Stage one. If the association is not due to bias confounding chance, it is true association. So there is no bias, there is no confounding, there is no chance. So stage two, we will go to if the associations are likely to be due to bias, the confounding, or if the associations are likely due to bias, confounding, or chance, we apply guidelines for causal inference. We apply the criteria. This criteria known as is Bradford Hill criteria is the name of the scientist. Bradford Hill criteria. So this criteria, after passing this pathway, this criteria is fulfilled, we can say the association is causal. Otherwise, we cannot say causal. So now we are passing the second concept, which is known as judgment of causality. Now we will judge the causality, judgment of causality. One cannot conclude that two cause and effect relationship from results of single observational study showing an association between exposure and disease. So that means if single study is reported there is association between one exposure and outcome, we cannot conclude there is cause and effect relationship, or cause effect relationship, or you can say causality. There is causality. So should be pass many steps. So the other properly conducted experimental trial do provide more direct proof of cause-effect relationship, yet are usually not possible because of ethical considerations. Because of ethical consideration, more experimental trials experimental trial by itself will give a properly conducted experimental trial will give a direct proof of cause-effect relationship, but usually we didn't get it. So in this case we have to it has been passing many steps, so we will see it now. But when we see the degree of study design, it will the strengths of design other than experimental is that we will the first one is that case series and report, then ecological, then cross-sectional, then case control, then cohort, then finally experimental have a good evidence to show causality, good evidence causality. So in the absence of experimental trial, establishing causation is a difficult process, so involving the consideration of number of criteria. Yeah. So if it is well conducted experimental trial, we can prove causation. Otherwise, we will go number of steps. So the following formal criteria are widely used to evaluate the likelihood that an association is causal. So this will all criteria is known as Bradford Hill criteria. So the first type of criteria is the strength of association. This refers to the degree or the level of relative risk. So the larger the relative risk, the greater the likelihood that the factor is causally related to the outcome. If the value of relative risk is more than 3 and 10, 20, if increases the magnitude, so the likelihood that factor is causally related to this increases. So now, to see the strength of association, we will see the amount of relative risk. So if the larger the number of the relative risk, this will increases the likelihood of causality. The likelihood of causality 1, 2 is dose response relationship. The likelihood of causal relation is strengthened if dose response effect or gradient effect is can be demonstrated. This means if the risk of disease increases with increasing the exposure with causal agent is another type. So in this case, dose response relationship, that means, for instance, let us see smoking and lung cancer. For instance, if the way smoking if there is more smoking, the level being diseased with lung cancer will be increased. This is dose response. For instance, if an individual who has smoked, if increases the number of cigarette packets and with frequency daily, if it increases also the probability being diseased with lung cancer will be increases. So if the risk factor increases, the outcome being harmed will be increases. This is known as dose response relationship. This is two criteria. The third criteria is consistency of the relationship. This means the criteria requires that an association uncovered in one study persists on testing under other circumstances with other study population and with different study methods. So the more often the association appears under diverse circumstances, the more likely it is to be causal in nature. Indicates that consistency means, for instance, one study in somewhere shows there is association between smoking and lung cancer. This finding will be similar with different studies, which is done in different study population, on different study type, and on using different methods. So in this case, there is consistency, so this increases the probability of causality. So mostly after doing a study in discussion of part of the research, we will discuss to which research finding is in agreement. So there is more agreement, more research agreed with our finding. This shows consistent, so it shows the causality. The fourth type is temporal relationship. This is very important, temporal relationship. So exposure to the suspected factor must antedate or precede the onset of disease. So it is more difficult to establish in many chronic conditions, especially those with long latent interval. By the way, temporal relationship is very important, and the first criteria it should be checked. That means risk factor or exposure should precede the effect. The fifth one is specificity of the association. The association is more likely causal if single exposure is linked to single disease. The sixth one is biological plausibility. This is known as coherence with existing information. This means that additional support for causal nature of an association exists if causal interpretation is plausible in terms of current knowledge about the factor and disease. By the way, there is a biological concept. So our finding, which we get, is doesn't far from or contradict the biological concept, or which is the knowledge which is known in nature. Contradict. This is known as biological plausibility. There is science, there is biological plausibility. So our finding should not contradict this one, or exposure, this relationship should not consider contradict this biological plausibility. It should be coherent with the existing information. This is known as the sixth criteria. The seventh one is that prevention. If the exposure is the cause of the disease, then eliminating the exposure should be followed by decrease in incidence rate of the disease. That means if some exposure will lead to the disease, if that exposure will be removed, the disease will be prevented. In this case, this is known as prevention. This is the seven criteria. This is the seven criteria. So to be the association is causal, we have to pass these steps: strength of association, dose response relationship, consistency, temporal relationship, specificity, biological plausibility, prevention. It should be so. The upper criteria are the ones that most frequently employed in trying to establish causation. This is known as Bradford Hill criteria. So the above seven criteria, which we have seen, is most commonly employed. Most commonly employed, by the way, some studies will add, or some books will add, as eight is study design. Study design, so study design, if the evidence of that study design that give more evidence increases, will be the probability causation increases. For instance, when we say study design at eight factor, for instance, the evidence of causation will be increases as we are going to from case report to ecological study, to ecological study to cross-sectional, from cross-sectional to case control, then to cohort, then experimental study. So as eight is a study design, so mostly we have used the criteria, this eight or seven Bradford Hill criteria. None provides in itself perfect means of providing causation. Each has its limitation. All have its own limitation. None has perfect. So, however, when they are considered together, the weight of the evidence may allow tentative conclusions to be reached. So that means, by the way, it says that considered together. That means, mostly, by the way, when compared from the seven, the most important thing is temporal relationship. Temporal relationship is the first, then the strength of association and consistency are very important. But the first one is that temporality. If temporality is violated, it's difficult to go to other criteria. But to say, very nice, from these seven criteria, more than three or four criteria are fulfilled, we can say reached the tentative conclusion of causality to causality. So combination of criteria is very important, very important. So it should be combined all. So this is all about the chapter, which is chapter 8. So now in this video we have seen about the confounding factor, and I've thinking about judgment of causality. Almost 7 up to 8 criteria will be judged. So this is all about this chapter. To get the next chapters, other courses, analysis, and different type of video in health, so don't forget to subscribe this channel. So thank you very much for watching this video. Have a nice time. Bye bye.